Chapter 2. The Composition of the Requiem. Although Mozart had not previously composed a requiem, the genre was not unknown to him. He was intimately familiar with the liturgical style from his years in Salzburg, where he regularly performed at and composed for the cathedral, from a variety of church music he encountered on his travels, and from his time in Vienna, where he had numerous opportunities to hear and study church music, both professionally and, no doubt, in his personal life as well. His appointment as successor to Leopold Hoffmann as music director at St. Stephen's was a recognition of his ability to write and direct sacred music appropriate to any occasion, a recognition he had already won for his secular music with his opera commissions and his appointment in December 1787 as court chamber musician to Joseph II. Church music had, in any case, occupied him on and off during his Vienna years, notwithstanding Joseph II's reforms and restrictions on local liturgical music. When he first moved to Vienna, he became attached to the circle of the Baron Gottfried van Swieten, prefect of the Imperial Library, who held regular musical gatherings at his home at which church music figured prominently, together with the fugues of Bach and Handel. And Joachim Daniel Preisler, a principal at the Theatre Royal in Copenhagen, who visited Mozart in 1788, wrote that he now writes church music in Vienna. Not entirely accurately, perhaps, since no finished liturgical music by him dates from that time. His comment may, however, be a reflection on Mozart's then-current compositional concerns, since a number of incomplete, fragmentary church works do survive for the period 1788 to 1790. In writing the Requiem, Mozart probably followed his usual compositional method. He thought about the genre and the gestures appropriate to its effect. He formulated at least the beginnings of a large-scale plan with respect to divisions of the text and their setting. He allowed his imagination free rein to invent appropriate musical gestures, themes, or motives. He explored these ideas at the keyboard, and finally, when he was sufficiently clear in his mind how the piece would go, what the succession of themes was, and how they might best be worked out, he committed it to paper. In the specific case of the Requiem, this meant writing down first the vocal parts, the bass line, and important instrumental motives, whether freestanding, as in the introductions to some sections of the Mass, or accompanimental. Once he had completed this task, he went back and filled in the rest of the orchestral parts. It is this working method that explains the incomplete state of the score, why for much of the work only vocal and bass parts are notated. But it also shows that, however complete or incomplete a work may have been in Mozart's imagination, he did not commit all of it to paper all at once, or in any fixed order from start to finish. The Domine Jesu is sketched out completely, but for the preceding Lacrimosa, only 8 bars of violins, bass, and voices are notated. And he orchestrated the introit before, apparently, moving on to the Sanctus, Benedictus, and Agnus Dei, those movements for which no Mozartian material survives at all. Ideas in the Requiem are entirely original to Mozart. Some derive from models known to him. It was common for 18th century composers to take pre-existing models and rework them in their own voices, while others derive from gestures common to both sacred and secular music of a particular effect. The very opening of the introit, for example, seems to rely on Handel's funeral anthem for Queen Charlotte, including not only the harmonic structure, but also the staggered entry of the voices. Mozart may well have known this work. Between 1788 and 1790, he was engaged by Van Swieten to make arrangements of several Handel oratorios, including Acis and Galatea, Messiah, Alexander's Feast, and the Ode for St. Cecilia's Day. A Handel enthusiast, Van Swieten may have owned and shown Mozart other works, including the funeral anthem. Yet Handel's theme also seems to be only one example of a type, of a motif common to tragic or funereal works. The same gesture is found in a requiem by the Viennese composer Florian Leopold Gassmann, including as well a rhythmic profile at Et Lux Perpetua, similar to Mozart's. Bach, too, made frequent use of such stock types. The chorale melody, Wenn mein Stündlein vorhanden ist, at the hour of my death, a text resonant with the Requiem, has the same melodic shape as Mozart's Requiem aeternam. And the outburst, Herr, at the opening of the St. John Passion, is strikingly similar to Mozart's Rex. These similarities may be nothing more than coincidental, a function of what, even in the late 18th century, remained aspects of a common musical language. The fact is that Mozart appears not to have been broadly acquainted with Bach's music, which was not widely disseminated in Vienna, although he certainly knew the well-tempered clavier and the motet Singet dem Herrn ein neues Lied. He was, however, well acquainted with Michael Haydn's Requiem for the Salzburg Archbishop Sigismund von Strattenbach. The Archbishop, Mozart's first patron, died on December 16, 1771, the day after Mozart's return home from his second Italian journey. And as a member of the court music, Mozart would have performed Haydn's work shortly after its completion on December 31. Like Mozart's Requiem, Michael Haydn's not only includes suspensions at the vocal entries and rhythmic uniformity at Et Lux Perpetua, but also a striking gesture in the violin accompaniment, successive syncopated leaps, sometimes over the course of an octave, that punctuate the supplicatory but nevertheless fearful Requiem aeternam.
Thank you.
The Kyrie fugue, too, is of a common type. It occurs in a major key form in Handel's Dettingen anthem, The King Shall Rejoice, of 1743. And a version of it was earlier used by Mozart himself in the Laudate Pueri of his solemn vespers Kirchhill 339 of 1780. The gambit of overlapping vocal entries, or for that matter overlapping instrumental entries, is not limited to the Requiem Aeternam, however, nor are its models strictly sacred. Mozart's Recordare is indebted, at least in type, to a Lacrimosa by the French composer François-Joseph Gossec, which begins in similar fashion. Most striking of all, it appears to duplicate, at least in part, including the walking bass line, a sinfonia by Wilhelm Friedemann Bach. Instrumental gestures, textures, chromaticisms, and cadences all have their precedence in the common musical language of the time. The aggressive strings of Mozart's Dies Irae are reminiscent of the aria But Who May Abide in Handel's Messiah, a work with which Mozart was intimately familiar. Mozart's chromatic setting of the text Oro supplex et acclinis, cor contritum quasi cinis, gere cura mei finis. I meekly and humbly pray, my heart is crushed as ashes, help me in my end, has its counterpart in Michael Haydn's Requiem. And Mozart, in his own Requiem, takes over the final cadence of Haydn's Quam olim abrahe fugue. And yet, for all the seeming precedents, for all that the common language of the time provided composers with a stock of gestures appropriate to any effect, it is nevertheless the case that no two gestures, no matter how similar, are really identical. Their contexts within any particular work and the individual voices of the composers effectively set them apart. Mozart's elaboration of Requiem Aeternam differs strikingly from Handel, Gassmann and Michael Haydn and leads to an entirely different ending, the gradual fading away of the eternal light sought so desperately by the supplicant. The same is true of Mozart's working out of the Kyrie fugue and his setting of the Recordare. One of Mozart's great concerns seems to have been unity, to link together different parts of the Requiem through gestures that reflect back on earlier moments in the work, with specific textual or affective meanings. The overlapping, rising suspensions at the start of the introit and the recordare are only one example. Many more may well have been intended for the orchestra, whose role in the Requiem has often not been given sufficient attention, partly because only the introit is fully scored, and partly because of the common belief that virtually all of the expressive substance of the work resides in the choral parts. The examples of Mozart's operas, however, gives ample evidence that even in vocal or choral music, much of Mozart's expressiveness lies on the surface of his works, on the shifting orchestral colours, and the ensemble's frequent participation as an independent, meaningful voice. In the Requiem, this is apparent both at the very start and at the very end of what Mozart was able to write, in the introit and the Quam olim abrahe fugue. As in the example from Michael Haydn, Mozart includes a striking part for the violins in the introit, frequently dissonant, thrusting octave leaps above the voices that reflect an underlying discomfort and uncertainty. But unlike Michael Haydn, Mozart returns to this gesture much later in the work, at Quam olim abrahe, where a similar gesture also serves to undermine the seeming supplication of the text. What is striking in Mozart's fugue is that in his score of the Domine Jesu, not a single orchestral part is notated, except for the violins as they introduce and accompany the fugue. Even at the most basic conceptual level, then, it seems that Mozart conceived of the orchestra as an independent voice in the work, even a voice contrary to the spirit of the text, and that, had he completed the work, the orchestral accompaniment would have been as rich and meaningful as the rest of it.